Maude Barlow.
Well, Anne, thank you so much for those beautiful words. I do not compare myself in any way, but I once read that after a very moving introduction, Winston Churchill said he could hardly wait to hear what he had to say. I always think those kinds of introductions should come after in case people say, oh, she wasn't that good. I want to thank you all for being here tonight. I want to thank you for your lovely introduction, Anne, and Dale Goldhawk for being here, for writing a book on Site 41. And I just saw the end of that book because the presentation that Margaret Prophet just made was just so powerful. Margaret, thank you. And your last name is the right name for you. You are a prophet here. And the Greenbelt Coalition. Thank you so much to Jeff Monag. The Beausoleil First Nation, particularly the women, were absolutely essential to the Site 41 struggle. And to Becky Binkin, thank you as well for being a water walker. And caring so much. It's just tremendous to be here tonight. So what I guess I want to say to you, we're going to leave lots of time for you to chat with Margaret and myself about the issues here in Simcoe County, but also globally. But I guess I want to start off, and I will end with this statement, and that is that we in Canada have taken our water for granted. We take nature for granted, in fact, and we all grew up being told, and it was still on the Environment Canada website until a couple of years ago, that we have 20% of the world's water. So we grew up with what I call the myth of abundance, and that truly is a myth. In fact, if you were to use that 20% of the world's water, we would drain every lake and river. We have about 6.5% of the world's available fresh water, but even that's not really true for those of us who live in the bottom half of Canada, because most of that water runs north in mighty rivers. And in fact, the 90% of Canadians who do live in the bottom sort of third of Canada, the south of Canada, the water yield, what they call the yield, is declining quite dramatically every year. So this notion that somehow the water problems, the water crises, the crises for people exist in other places, like poor countries in faraway countries, we've got to get over this notion. We have a water crisis developing here in Canada, and if we don't deal with it soon, we're going to start experiencing what people around the world have experienced. Now, it's really important that we look to other countries and compare ourselves, not to countries that didn't have a lot of water to start with, but let's look at just three countries that actually have a lot of water, and they're still listed in the top 10 water-rich countries in the world by the United Nations. One of them is China, believe it or not, and we know that the water crisis there is terrible from the pollution aspect, but they also have disappearing water. And in fact, in China, since 1990, over half the major rivers in China have disappeared. They're gone. So when Margaret talks about, is it possible for the Great Lakes to recede to the point where they don't exist anymore? Yes, you bet. You bet this is possible in a water-rich country. Brazil is another incredibly important story for us. Brazil is listed by the UN as the country that has the most water in the world. And they have no history of drought up till about a dozen years ago, when all of a sudden they started having this massive drought in the south, down in the southern regions of their country. And they couldn't understand where this was coming from. Was it suddenly climate change? Did suddenly the greenhouse gas emissions change everything? Because there are now about 120 million people in the greater Sao Paulo area in crisis. No, it turns out that because they cut down so much of the Amazon, they changed the atmosphere. The Amazon rainforest, like Canada's forest, but particularly rainforest, gives off a tremendous amount of moisture. And that moisture is carried on what they call flying rivers. There are currents of moisture in the air, in the atmosphere. In fact, there is more water in flying rivers around the world than there is in the actual rivers of our planet. This is stuff I learned as I went along. I didn't start off knowing any of this. I came into it from a justice perspective, but you soon learn that you can't talk about justice without talking about the water crisis itself.
So what happened is that the water stopped coming, these rain currents, these flying rivers stopped bringing rain into the south. And there's now a crisis in a country that never had crisis before. And when I tell you it happened in a dozen years, that's true. The United States is a country that has a great deal of water, great water wealth, that they are dumping so many toxins into their groundwater legally. And they are moving water from one place to another legally, and they are pulling up groundwater so fast that they're destroying the water systems they have. The Ogallala Aquifer is the aquifer that goes down the spine of the United States and is the major reason that Obama said no to the Keystone Pipeline. That aquifer is being depleted so quickly that the U.S. Department of Agriculture says it will be gone in our lifetime. Now, this was an aquifer that was larger than Lake Huron at one point. But they discovered this bore well technology in the 1950s, and they suddenly were able to green the deserts, including Western Canada, by pulling up groundwater far faster than it can be replenished by nature. California is another area that we should look at, the most water engineered place on Earth. They have a water abundance. They're not even talking about drought in California anymore. They're saying that they've actually changed the geography, they've changed the geologic reality of California. And so this is the reality for around the world. Ban Ki-moon, the Secretary General of the UN, said that they pulled 500 scientists around the world last year, and they said that our mistreatment and abuse of water is bringing in a new geologic age, much like the ice melting of 11,000 years ago. So we are in a planet in water crisis, but it's really important for us to understand that we're part of that crisis too. Climate change is warming lakes around the world, no place greater than in Canada. In fact, the lakes that are warming the fastest are the Great Lakes, particularly Lake Superior. Our glaciers, all of them, are melting. All of our Arctic lakes are in decline. What happens and what they've learned is that as the permafrost melts, first of all, in the spring there's more runoff than ever, and you think, oh, tons of water, but when the permafrost finishes melting, those shallow lakes dry up. Our groundwater is at serious risk of chemical and other pollution and overextraction. But as Margaret said, neither at the federal level nor the provincial level have we mapped this groundwater. We don't know what we're taking. You use the image of the bank account. I use the image of people around a bathtub with blindfolds and straws, and everybody's taking that water as much as they want and as fast as they want, and there's lots of water until there's no water, and that's the exponential overuse of our water. We're taking down our forests and our wetlands, again, at an alarming rate. 70% of all the wetlands around the Great Lakes are now gone. And this, of course, in turn, leaves our water unprotected. We dump 150 billion liters of untreated or undertreated sewage into our lakes and rivers every year. And we dumped untold amounts of chemicals as well. Toxicity data are missing for 87% of all chemicals sold in the Canadian market. We just don't know what we're putting in. Every year we pour more than 35 million kilograms of herbicides and pesticides onto agricultural lands. And Canada allows chemicals and pesticides such as glyphosate, which is the Roundup Ready herbicide, and the hormone disruptor atrazine, not allowed in places like Europe. And this has been one of the big issues when we've been talking to Europeans and saying, don't sign this CETA, this Comprehensive Economic and Trade Agreement, because our standards have become lower, steadily lower, much more harmonized to the US since NAFTA. Microsystems, which are the potentially fatal toxins found in blue-green algae, have been found in 246 lakes in Canada. Eutrophication, that nutrient overload, is killing Lake Winnipeg and seriously threatening Lake Erie. And it's back with a vengeance because, again, we are using so many chemicals and herbicides allowing food production, which, again, was not something that was very typical even 10 years ago in Canada. And we know that while we have some standards not necessarily good enough for human sewage, we have no standards whatsoever for animal waste. That waste goes into huge lagoons, which ends up into our groundwater, our streams and rivers, and our lakes. And we're failing our First Nations, as we know. Two-thirds of all First Nations have been under a drinking water advisory in the last decade, and the situation is not getting better, it's getting worse. So we think we love our water, and it's certainly in our music, in our literature, and we feel that it's part of who we are, but actually we take very bad, poor care, and our governments have taken poor care. Canada's water management is a patchwork of uneven and often inadequate regulation and standards, and we desperately need a strong water plan, and we need the federal government to take the responsibility that it has. Our Water Act, National Water Act, is from 1970. It's totally inadequate and hasn't been properly enforced, and it's way out of date. Budgets for Environment Canada's water protection has been starved from the beginning. Huge cuts dramatically hit the water budget in Paul Martin's cuts of 1995 to 97. But nobody has hurt our water laws the way Stephen Harper did. He brought in, first of all, a loophole to the Fisheries Act, actually allowing lakes that are to be reclassified as toxic impoundment areas. In other words, they're no longer lakes. Their mines can dump their toxins in, and they can become sewage dumps or toxic dumps and not protected by the Fisheries Act. But that didn't go far enough. In the 2012 omnibus bill, they gutted the Fisheries Act, the Navigable Waters Protection Act, and the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act. And with these changes, 99% of all lakes and rivers in Canada are totally unprotected. Pipelines carrying explosive gas or tar sands bitumen loaded with chemicals such as benzene can now pass over, under, or around 31,000 lakes and 2.25 million rivers with no federal scrutiny whatsoever. Harper also waged war on scientists. They fired 2,000 of them. And hundreds of research projects and institutes facilities dealing with water purity, water protection, and so on were gutted or closed altogether. They hugely cut the water provisions or the water protection projects of Environment Canada, the Department of Fisheries and Oceans, and Parks Canada. And the number of inspections for environmental crimes fell off a cliff, according to one senior scientist. In fact, the head of the department's environmental branch charged with implementing the Canadian Environmental Protection Act retired last January, and he put out a statement when he left, and he said, "I have to tell you that they are breaking the law. We are not even enforcing the Canadian Environmental Protection Act at the moment. We're just looking the other way at any crime that any industry wants to make is going unchallenged." Said another senior scientist, "In 31 years of the job, never have I witnessed such a systemic destruction of the scientific capability of the Federal Public Service. Science has been cut to the bone. There is no way to further cut it without just stopping." No, none of that has been reinstated a year into the new government. Now, we also have, so we've got government, we've got a bad record, we've got government neglect, and we have growing corporate abuse because we are becoming more and more reliant on the exploitation of our natural resources for export. So just to give you an example or a stat, 30 years ago, manufacturing accounted for about 26% of our GDP. Now it's down to 11%. So that means that we're sending more fish and more logs and more minerals and everything away, and that has a huge detrimental impact on our waterways. There's been a huge increase in oil exports in the last decade, much of it from the Alberta tar sands, which is the largest industrial project on Earth. Current tar sands operations remove a volume of water from the Athabasca River that is more than twice the amount of water used every year by Calgary. 95% of that water is too polluted to return to the river. It's held in great big, huge, toxic lakes, basically, tailings ponds that leach over 11 million liters of toxic water every single day into the groundwater. Canada's water is also at risk from the proposed pipelines because they would carry bitumen from the tar sands diluted with these chemicals to make them liquid enough to pass through the pipelines. So we're fighting Energy East, which will pass over almost 300 waterways and put the drinking water of 5 million people at risk, similarly the Western pipelines. And the Trudeau government today announced a $1.5 billion fund for cleanup of oil spills in the ocean. And I'm sorry, I don't mean to be suspicious, but it makes me think that this is a precursor to saying yes to at least one of these pipelines, so that that fund is there when the pipelines burst. And make no mistake, these pipelines spill. In Alberta alone, there's been an average of 2 spills per day for the last 3 decades. And I have this really meticulously documented in my book, because like Naomi Klein calls the documentation her armor. You really, you know, trust me that this is well documented. The Great Lakes are becoming a carbon corridor carrying bitumen by rail and pipelines. There's Line 5 under the Great Lakes. It's 67 years old. It should be closed down, but it is now carrying refined bitumen from the tar sands and fracking fracked oil and gas as well. And now, increasingly, they're talking about carrying it on barges on the lakes. In fact, the U.S. Coast Guard has given the green light to carry fracked wastewater on waterways, on barges, on American waterways. So that would be the Great Lakes as well. Fracking consumes and poisons huge amounts of water. It's not an issue yet here, but in Alberta and BC, they have opened 40,000 fracking wells in the last decade, and they're planning at least another 40 to 50,000 in the next decade. Mining is on the rise. Mining, dumping heavy metals and toxic waste into rivers, lakes, and groundwater. And Mining Watch Canada says that Ontario has by far the worst record in terms of keeping protecting our water and health from mines, both active and former mines, closed mines. And many lakes, as they say, are being killed with the toxic runoff from the way we grow food, much more corporate-oriented, much more industrial-based, and so on. In the book, I document many other corporate threats, including the privatization of our municipal water services, which is a huge issue where, you know, again, under Harper, if you were going to invest in water infrastructure and you needed federal funding, you had to go to a public-private partnership. Water trading, which Alberta's introduced, where you convert the permit or the license to an actual property, and so you can trade water as if it's a property, which it is in that case. And the latest is water pollution trading, and it's in Ontario that started. And I report on a very important study that was done in the U.S. on water pollution trading, where these big factory farm operations or nuclear facilities just continue to poison the local water, but they have an offset somewhere else, or they pay their way out of having to obey the law. We have also bottled water exports. When Nestle's new well comes on board, they'll be taking over 6 million liters a day from the wells near Elora, and this is on the Grand River system that is in some distress, and where 11,000 First Nations people do not have access to clean water coming out of their taps. And we have called for a boycott of Nestle, and would urge you to go to our website and join the boycott or sign the petition at the back. And we're even seeing a return to the debate about commercial exports of our raw water. You'll remember, those of you who've been watching this over a number of decades, that this issue comes and goes. But the Vancouver-based Fraser Institute, the Montreal-based Economic Institute, the Manitoba-based Frontier Centre for Public Policy, the University of Calgary School of Public Policy, former PM John Chrétien, former U.S. Ambassador Gary Doer, CIBC's Jeff Rubin, and many others I quote in the book have been calling for Canada to open up commercial export of our water, citing that the United States is going to need it. A man named Parag Khanna is the best-selling author, international relations expert, and CNN Global contributor and senior research fellow at the National University of Singapore. And a book that he wrote that just came out called Connectography, Mapping the Future of Global Civilization. He says that Americans should get to know the names of the Canadian provinces, because that's where their water will likely come from in the future. And And he says we have to revive the Nawapa and the Grand schemes, which were huge export schemes that got squashed. And he said we have to take a page from Chinese and Dutch experiences using dikes and canals to move water. He says Arizona, Nevada, and California are running out and reminds us, and I quote, without Canadian water, it is hard to imagine the United States continuing to produce one-third of the world's corn and feed the Colorado River. So this issue has not gone away. We are living next to a very hungry superpower, a very thirsty superpower, and this issue is going to come up. And I also have a whole chapter on trade, which I won't go into here, but how issues of the investor state protection of NAFTA, the upcoming CETA with Europe, the proposed Trans-Pacific Partnership, all give corporations the right to sue the Canadian government if we try to protect our water. We're currently facing $2.6 billion worth of challenges from American corporations over trying to protect our environment. So our task now is to hold the new government's feet to the fire. When they were in opposition, they were wonderful on water. They had a water critic. They promised to have a water department, a water minister. None of that's happened. They did put serious money aside for First Nations water and sanitation in the budget, so this is good. And they did put some money back into the funds that were so badly depleted. But they are looking to say yes to these pipelines. They are saying yes to the LNG terminals out west. They're going to give money to the northern development and so on, and they have not yet said, they have not yet fulfilled their promise to undo the gutting of the Three Water Act. So we really need to say to this government, we need a strong national water strategy, working with the provinces, First Nations, and municipalities, and we need national drinking water standards. We need standards on the way we grow food, the way we produce energy, the way we trade across nations. We have to have what I call a new water ethic, based on the principles of water being a human right, water being a public trust, and water having its own rights outside of its usefulness to us. Water serving itself, serving the ecosystem, water protecting other life, not just our own. And we need this ethic very, very badly. And that's that when people say, well, what can I do as an individual? And I say, lots. But if we don't come together and build something greater than that, and we don't insist on good policy, what you do individually is not going to be enough. Martin Luther King said, legislation may not change the heart, but it will restrain the heartless, which I think it tells us that we need good legislation and we don't have it, and we have to insist on it, because I've traveled around the world and I've seen too many places where they woke up and realized that they had treated their water very badly and were paying for it now. So I'm just going to end the formal part of this with two quick things. One is that I just want to say a shout out to everyone in this room who was part of the Site 41 fight. I write about it briefly here, and Dale's going to write about it in great detail in his upcoming book. But this was an incredible fight. It took decades, and people just said, we are not giving up. And it was the real leadership came from First Nations, from young people, from seniors, from farmers, just ordinary people coming together and saying, we have a deep belief that we can do something. And I just want to read to you a little bit about describing what happened, because they started arresting people. 17 people were arrested for blocking construction of the site, including a number of Indigenous protesters and farmers. Ina and Keith Wood, then 76 and 82, were included when they received the call to present themselves to the Midland OPP detachment. Ina was baking butter tarts for the local church. Keith, who died in early 2016, was not fazed by his first arrest. I like to look after my heritage, he said, which is land and water. My grandparents lived here 150 years ago, and I have 7 grandchildren, and that's who I'm doing this for. We finally, together, got the Simcoe County Council to come together to vote on whether they would hold a moratorium or not. And it was on August the 25th, so the end of summer, at 6 years ago this summer, and it wasn't 7 years ago this summer, and it was an absolutely wild event. For any of you who were not there, let me tell you, there were hundreds and hundreds of people. Everybody, as many as could, piled in and sat up in the balcony, but there were hundreds more outside, and we had loudspeakers, and people were throwing buns, and it was democracy in its wildest. And I just want to read to you just the very end of this. Tiny Township Mayor Peggy Breckenridge led the speakers in favor of the moratorium and gave a passionate defense of the need to protect the area's water. She was greeted with a standing ovation. But the day was probably won when Scott Warnick, mayor of Tay Township and a staunch supporter of Site 41, rose to speak. The vote was going to be close, and his words would help sway the undecided. There were about a third opposed, and this middle group, and we didn't know where they were going to go. Warnick started to speak, but had to catch his breath as he choked up with tears. He explained when he went into his home office that morning, his grandchildren had taken one of the stop Site 41 signs and written the word Papa on it. Warnick said in that moment, his job description changed, and he was now a steward of the waters of Simcoe County. He urged his fellow councillors to oppose the dump. The moratorium was adopted 22-10. Less than a year later, the county council voted to rezone the landfill for agricultural use, and the province revoked the certificate of approval for Site 41. The land has been sold to a farmer and is once again producing food. Aware Simcoe helped defeat most of the councillors who had supported the dump in the next election. The precedent of Site 41 victory was key in defeating the opening of a mega quarry in nearby Malathan Township several years later. It was just an amazing moment to be there and to experience what a people united can come together and do. I just wanted to share that with you. My last thoughts are my very last words of the book. 2 decades ago, I asked Oscar Oliveira, the leader of the first water war, what it was about water that inspired the kind of courage he and others had displayed while standing up to the army in his country. At the direction of the World Bank, Cochabamba, Bolivia allowed Bechtel to privatize and run its water services. The company tripled the price of water, making it too expensive for the majority of its largely indigenous poor population. It even started fining people for capturing rainwater. The people rose up against terrible odds. Many were hurt, some were killed, but they did not back down, and Bechtel was forced to abandon Bolivia. Oscar was a shoemaker by trade and had never done anything like this before, but his anger at the injustice of the situation gave him courage he didn't know he had. Why water, he said, knowing I meant that there were many other terrible injustices his people, the Aymara, had endured over time. Because, he said, water is life. Local water is personal, mine, ours. How dare they claim it for their faraway investors? And, he said, because I would rather die of a bullet than of thirst. I remember that conversation a decade later when I made my first tour of Alberta's tar sands. Accompanying our group were some activists from the Athabasca Chipewyan First Nation that lives downstream from the site. Among them was a young leader named Mike Mercury. At a press conference we held in Edmonton to describe what we saw and experienced on the tour, Mercury tried to explain what life was like for his people. Sometimes, he said, you just look around and you say, where did all of this come from? Some nights when you're out there, out in the lake, or you're in the bush, you look toward the south, you can actually see the lights glowing from industry, which tells us this thing is coming. It's coming towards us. The trees are gone, they're being cut, the land is upside down, and the water is being poisoned. It's like a moonscape out there. Mercury said that his people could no longer drink the water and were covered with sores and cysts when they swam in it. He said that people were dying, including members of his family. And now when I read the next part, you'll realize why I'm comparing him to Oscar Oliveira. And he said it would be kinder to come in with guns and to kill them quickly than to do it this way. The water crisis is at our door here in Canada. All the issues we thought were so far away are upon us. us now. A greater challenge has never faced the peoples of Canada. Each and every one of us has a personal responsibility to take action and collectively confront the very power structures that have prevented the kind of change needed to protect and honor the great water heritage.